good. I'm Lawrence Heiner. I'm with Workforce Equanimity. This here is
Aaron Brown, or AB, or
also with Workforce
Equanimity.
Thank you. Cool. So, welcome. And today we're going to be talking about creating intentionally diverse teams as our follow up to
last week, right?
Last week, where we discussed diverse teams also. But this week we're looking at putting people together, right? So we're creating the team.
Yeah, because it kind of makes me think, right? It's once we understand diversity for what it is, how do we get them to play nice and focus on one thing together with those unique strengths and weaknesses?
Right, yeah. So we know diversity. Now we got to accomplish the team goal.
There it is.
Yeah. So today we'll take a look at picking that team, make it an all-star team. What kind of tools are we going to need for that? Some of the dangers that are out there when people choose from their gut instead of from what's in front of them. And then we'll talk about high performers and then future high performers, how they're overutilized or underutilized.
Nice.
Cool. All right.
How do you pick a team, Lawrence?
Oh, all right. So picking an all-star team. So first thing is, when you're looking at your team, you've got a lot of choices out there. And when we think of an all-star team, sometimes we think about all all-star players, right? And when we're putting a team together, we all may want to have that team of all-star players, but if you look at it a little bit deeper, you may not, right? So taking a peek at what happens when you get those egos together, or if you've got the right matched skills together, you know, people who are individually awesome at what they do may not come together to form Voltron, right? You know, like you may need some talent in different areas to gel that team together. So when you're looking at the team, you have to identify not just is that person good at what they do, but are they going to be a good fit in the team that you're putting together?
Got it. So it makes me think, so a question for you, Lawrence. So let's say as bands, music for a minute, so we're going to go on the music road. What's a band that comes to mind that you feel is great?
I'm going to go with Zeppelin.
Okay.
Led Zeppelin came together as a band, decades ago in the 70s, putting together arguably some of the best rock and roll music that has ever existed. But the people that formed the band weren't necessarily the best guitar and singing and drums and bass playing, but together they really complemented one another, so you can pick out the talent that's represented in the band. Beatles are another good example. You had really good writers in McCartney and Lennon, and then their playing skills kind of came together. Even Ringo Starr being brought on after the original Beatles was put together to fill in as another drummer and got notoriety that way. If you listen to the music and you listen to the isolated instruments, you may not say, yeah, that's the most impressive drum playing that I've ever heard, but on balance with the rest of the team, it may be some of the best songs you've ever heard.
Yeah, it kind of makes, for me, I'm thinking we'll go with Tower Power for a moment.
All right.
Not everyone is a great singer in that group.
Sure, yeah.
But of course, to kind of talk about what we talked about last week, is you have all these unique talents, and went, like you said, you bring them all together, so musically they perform some of the, if not greatest, most memorable bands, being one vision, one song, one album, whatever it might be that you can possibly think of.
Sure. You would see that even in symphony spaces, where people are at the top of their game, but then when they get there, they need to learn to play together, and then that's where you've got a talented team leader or a maestro in the front of the room that is going to take all of that talent and bring it together in a cohesive way.
Cohesive. Yeah. All right. So what do we have next?
Tools. Yeah. So let's take a look at how you measure the talent of the people that you're bringing on the team.
Yeah. So I'm thinking for myself. So sticking if Aaron was going to build this perfect band, something that I would highly recommend It's observation. It's huge. Watching not just how someone plays a bass or how someone drums, but how do they take feedback? Are they coachable? Mm-hmm. Do they provide feedback to others? How well do they get along as a team? Something I know for myself, outside of this, I am also, hey, what do you know? I'm in a music group, right? So outside of performing and practicing, it's really spending time to gel by having lunch, having dinner, whatever it might be. Because those are, I believe, valuable things you have to be able to observe as, let's say, Lawrence was putting together this perfect band or whatever it might be. It's how do they communicate? How do they just bond? Do they share information about themselves? Are they comfortable sharing? Kind of like the trust piece. Do they trust one another and whatnot? And I think there's some other tools we talked about yesterday that you can probably take us on the road on also.
Yeah, sure. There, a couple of things that come to mind. You've got some standard kind of skills testing tools. A lot of organizations do. Some are homegrown, some are purchased. And they can measure people's abilities in certain areas. It can measure people's behavioral styles and if they mesh or not. And those are great tools to help put a team together so you can see from a skills standpoint or from a personality standpoint how they're going to mesh on paper, right? I love what you talked about with observation. That's pretty critical if it's available. Some people who are putting the team together may not have that kind
True.
Of recruiter, you know, look at the rookie player play on the field at a practice before they come in on the team. Mm-hmm. So we've got things like interviews that can help with that. The other thing that a lot of organizations are struggling with right now is how do you take people that have been with an organization for a long time and record their successes and their coaching progress over time? The classic way was to do annual performance reviews, and those have had their value in the past, and a lot of them are embedded in the systems that organizations use. Many, many companies are pushing in a new direction with that. Some are looking at like a constant performance review. So any touch point with an employee in a formal way can come back and be recorded as a progressive look at their career, show where their strengths are, show what they're trying to learn, and show their trajectory. Some are breaking up the year into quarters or months and looking at incremental reviews and saving the annual performance review for more specialized things like raises or bonuses, that kind of financial incentives that work on a regular schedule, but are not really that good for catching people in the moment when it's a month or two in, right? I mean,
yeah.
You've probably both experienced where you do something great, you know, and it gets overshadowed by the last couple of months before the performance review. So when it comes to a selection tool, that annual review is only as good as the reviewer makes it, and an organization can't really rely on the talent of every manager to do that accurately every time. It's just too difficult for the regular human being. I'm sure there are superstar managers that really nail it.
Absolutely.
But there are much easier ways for the regular Clark Kents of the world to do that on a more consistent basis and really provide value to that person as being in the selection pool for teams.
Okay, mm-hmm. Let's move on to the next. I think it's going to transition. So it made me think. We have the performance review. Month one, awesome performance, Lawrence. Month two, you're still a rock star. Month three, we have a few undulations, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
And thinking of the knee-jerk reactions, what type of things do you feel that could possibly happen as a manager quickly assuming something?
Yeah, so... With managers in selecting teams or in team leads selecting teams, a lot of times the knee-jerk reaction is to pick people who will agree with you all the time to make it easier, right? And if you have the vision of where you need a particular project to go, a certain element of that is important. You need to find people that are in alignment with what you're talking about and are coachable to where you need to take a project. The danger is not inviting in points of view that may be constructively challenging, right? So one of the things that a good team selector will do is find points of view that are not necessarily all in 100% alignment, but that deviate enough to provide a little bit of feedback to the leader, right? And people who aren't afraid to identify when a project is going off the rails. If you've got a leader that is so focused on the goal that they're missing the fact that the whole project is failing and could just take a little steering here or there, that could be a big problem, right? So the knee-jerk reaction to avoid in that case would be selecting people that may not be the most comfortable people to work with, but maybe the best people for that team to get the job done.
Correct. And something else I'm thinking about is, let's say I'm building my team. Another knee-jerk reaction I've seen, it's the person, so let's say, is coming from a different location. Mm-hmm. Maybe even a different department. Let's go that route, right? And based on what the performance review states that has taken place in the last 3 weeks, I quickly make a decision of, I'm not going to allow this person to come to my location. Based on something that maybe has taken place 3 weeks ago, knee-jerk reaction, whereas kind of a little bit what you're saying, it's there's homework that we should do. There should be some research that we should be doing. Let's say if it's a brand new candidate, maybe we don't get the opportunity to observe because they're brand new to the industry or whatever it might be. What are some things would you recommend for that type of scenario?
That new person coming in is frequently seen as green or doesn't really understand the nuance to the company's mission or how a particular project may fit into that. And I know we're going to talk about that in a moment, but it is fair to say that the knee jerk is to say that this is a really important project. I need the right people to do it, and I don't have time to nurse somebody along and show them the ropes on this project. Where in fact, that may be the best opportunity to show the intensity of how important projects may be and give an opportunity. So Aaron, let's talk about the team selection and what happens when we're trying to pick a lot of high performers. High performers are really important. So what's the deal with picking high performers on the team?
Okay, so let's go this way. We'll go back to music for a moment. So one thing I've seen happen before is you get a lot of bass players, mm-hmm. right? So you look for I want my best players that I can possibly get. And unfortunately, sometimes I believe our vision gets very narrow. We say we want this one type, which unfortunately sometimes turns into, hey, I want more of me because I know I'm great at what I have done because I've exceeded and I've been promoted numerous times. Now I'm a manager of X, Y, and Z. But again, it's now you unfortunately sometimes get so inward focused versus outward focused. You now have numerous bass players. If we go with the soccer analogy, we have a lot of left-handed kickers that are now on the left side of the field. We have no one running on the right side of the field. Mm-hmm. Second obstacle is, makes me think, one, we'll backpedal a little bit, how you say we have the successful folks saying, yes, Lawrence, I will do everything. Absolutely. A lot of the times, they're the ones going home exhausted. They're the ones that don't have that extra energy when you need it. And sadly, they're not always the one to say, Lawrence, can I have a break? Or ask, can I have a break? Or Lawrence, I need a break. It's, yes, I'll do above and beyond. Mm-hmm. I'm taking it a step further, which we haven't talked about, the employees that maybe aren't getting the opportunities and not getting the chances to shine. Their morale, their growth is now being, I believe, let's say, not being nurtured, right? Because now you're putting all this energy on your higher performance. And I know in a moment we're going to talk about those potential higher performers. They're not getting that development that typically they're very hungry to receive to get to the next level.
Yeah, the the burnout rate on high performers is also a challenge. So, you know, those a lot of times there are those people who really thrive when they're performing at their peak. Other times you've got people who are very talented at what they do and they're being overtasked. Mm-hmm. So, you know, like the more introverted part of the group that may be very good at what they do, they're constantly put into team environments and they're starting to burn out. And the company itself runs the risk of driving those high performers out of their business based on the culture that the organization has in overtasking high performers, particularly, as you point out, when there are other options available. So I think it's obvious to a certain degree how overutilizing high performers is a problem. Let's look at underutilizing future high performers. You've been alluding to that quite a bit, Aaron. So
yeah.
What do we mean by future high performers?
We know as a leader, especially let's say if we are the people who made the decision to hire these six people, I believe sometimes we do forget why we made the decision to hire them in the first place. Mm-hmm. Because maybe they're not performing to the expectation that we set when we had that conversation, when we provided that offer letter, whatever that might look like for the company specifically. And then again, it does impact their morale in a negative way. They have so much growth for opportunity, we're not tapping into it, so instead we're tapping into the typical cream of the crop, if you will. Also, taking it a step further, I'm thinking of this, right? It ties into, if we're underutilizing, then that ties into attrition, possibly. Mm-hmm. Because a underutilized future high performer wants to be utilized, what do you know?
Right.
It's like having an energetic German Shepherd, because I have one of those. If I'm not playing with the energetic German Shepherd that wants to play, when people come to my home, what does Bo do? Bo, I want to go play with someone. I want to go do something because I have this will and this want and this passion, this drive to play fetch for 12 hours straight. If you're not going to do it, I'm going to find someone that will give me the time that I need. But what's awesome about thinking of that as an analogy for a moment, it's if someone else takes time to interact with my German Shepherd, he picks up new skills. He becomes now more obedient. He's now more willing to entertain, more willing to listen when I tell him, Bo, go sit in the corner, because someone's now picking up that gap. From there, what it turns into is when I come home, Bo wants nothing to do with me anymore. Bo wants something to do with Lorenzo that's coming over, or whatever it might be.
Nice, yeah. Well, and I can imagine Bo, if he's not played with much, he's going to go wander onto Facebook in the corner and started entertaining himself for a while. So, yeah, I think that kind of passionate person shows up in our team, and sometimes they go unnoticed. I mean, they may not be jumping up and down in front of you, in Bo's case, literally, but, you know, for a lot of folks who are very talented, there's a reason why they were chosen by somebody.
True.
They may not have been your choice. You may have inherited a team, a small team, a large team, and identifying what it is that is a driver for each of those people on the team, the resources that are at your disposal, is really, really critical, not just for the success of teamwork, but also success for the individual. Another thing that comes to mind, and I want to circle this back to diversity, is that when the team organizer is subject to their own bias, right? And not to stand on any political third rails here, but the implications I think are going to be obvious. When people are picking based on their own bias, there's a lot of unconscious bias that influences that. So the thing that stands out to me most in my experience most is that, like we've been talking a lot about, like, are they going to just agree with me? And there's a lot of ways that people judge whether or not somebody is going to agree with them all the time. It may be that race, sex, religion, that kind of thing has an influence on the leader, but that's not always the case. It is frequent that people are just, hey, these are my party people. They're going to get it. They're a lively group. They're like the extroverts that are in my team. Oh, the extroverts are going to be great on this. I can't really have any introverts on this team because we really need to go out and be energetic and in front of people. So those are the risks that come into play, particularly when you're looking at the future high performers, because they may not show the behavior that you're unconsciously biased toward. Right. A lot of times people, because we deal with behavioral assessments a lot of times people will start talking about, oh, yeah, this will be a great tool for selection when I'm hiring people. And I need to slow them down. Like, no. It's because of that unconscious bias as a main point. There are others. But the unconscious bias of saying, oh, OK, well, I'll assume that based on their behavioral profile, they're going to act in these particular ways or have these particular skills, and those are not correlated. There's some minor correlation, but just because somebody is more of a people person doesn't mean that they cannot perform in a individual capacity or settle down into individual work and knock out some really, really great work. You just have to give them the opportunity. You have to provide them the guidance. And it's important to set the expectation of the goal and allow a little bit of give and take for yourself as a group leader to receive the feedback that's necessary for the group to succeed, for the project to succeed.
Nice. And where I was, you kind of said a few things, a lot of great things, and one huge nugget I received was as a leader, we really have the control of what behavior becomes norm. Mm-hmm. What I mean by that, going back to the German Shepherd analogy, eventually, if I'm not giving him the time that he needs to play or whatever it might be, eventually Bo now sits in the corner when I come home from work. Bo now, that becomes his habit. That's the culture in my home is, okay, it's not normal for me to jump up and give you attention when you come through the door. It's, I'm just going to sit here in this corner by myself because now he's being underutilized. Mm-hmm. So I believe that's another huge call out there is as a leader to be sensitive to those habits that your reps tend to learn like puppies do, as children learn. It's, we have a lot to do with how that adjusts. And I love how you said, just because if you're not a people person or whatever it might be, doesn't mean you can't be great in certain areas. Mm-hmm. But then again, I believe as a leader, we can pull and nurture different talents and gifts and strengths that they do have that they may not know they have also, which allows for them to possibly change. They may be kind of quiet. 3 months later, if we give and take, now they're interacting differently. Well, they're interacting at least, right? They're working with people inside of that location.
Yeah, and we're going to talk in future sessions about the manager as coach, and there's a balance there, but a really good coaching technique is understanding when you need to push people just a little bit outside of their comfort zone, when that's way too far and you scared them away, and when to have a discussion with somebody to ask, hey, what are the areas that you are interested in growing in and really utilizing them on a team like this.
Nice.
Any final thoughts?
Not on my end. How about you?
I'm good. But we are really interested in hearing what kind of questions people have out in the wide, wide world. As this recording goes up and you're listening to it, you can send us your questions to info@workforceeq.com or to any of our social media channels. We're on pretty much everything these days. Facebook and
Instagram,
Twitter.
Need to learn, get on Snapchat. Maybe we'll figure that out. I don't know.
Maybe in Snapchat world. But you'll find us at handle WorkforceEQ. That's also WorkforceEQ.com. So we look forward to your conversation, your participation. And we will catch you next week.
Yep. Till next week. Enjoy the remainder of the week and be great.
Cool. Thanks.